Hey, you guessed it. It's about that time for another training session in MicroVellum Toolbox. So as always, let's open up that project and we'll get right into it. So we've had this scribe filler added flush to the face to this product here. We change our view, we get a better visual of what's happening. I don't know if X-ray is any better, is it? Yeah. Anyway, it's not bad. Cool. So you can see basically what's happening, right? We have our filler that's flush to our door, but there's really no way to attach it to the cabinet. So we got to figure something out. Sure, we can have something cut by hand inside of the shop during assembly, but I'd rather have something as part of the product that we can have labeled and make sure that ends up on our shipping report. So let me go ahead and just isolate this cabinet. I don't really like that X-ray view. I'm going to get into a wireframe. That's a lot easier to see what's going on. Okay, so a couple different ways that we can add a part to a product. I'm going to show you the easiest way and the way that I found myself pretty much always doing it at the beginning, and until I started really getting used to working with the spreadsheets and, you know, and how powerful that can be. So, but this is the way to do it as we get started working on adding new parts. Now, as we talked about, the right side here is the list of the carcass parts, and on the left we have our subassemblies. Now, I could add a new part to our carcass list over here, but I want to kind of keep it in the family of the subassembly. So I'm going to go into our scribe filler, right click, show properties, and here are the different cut parts for our scribe filler. So we have our filler return. One thing that's nice about our part properties, let me see if I can move my window around so you can see it. Well, I guess I'll have to do it like that. Move that guy over there, bring my window back. Okay. So as I select on the part, bottom return gets highlighted, filler return gets highlighted. So that's kind of nice. One thing that you don't get when you're using the spreadsheet. Now, I'm sure there's people out there that, you know, definitely prefer one over the other. I'm not going to say one's better than the other. I think they both have value. So that's kind of how I feel about that. Okay, so now back to adding a new part. I'm going to right click on my list and add a new part. So this can be a brand new part that comes in with basically no information, right? It's just a new part, has one quantity, width, length, material, all needs to be updated. Every time you select it, obviously you get this little window popping up, letting you know there's no material. Let's see if I can get past that. Yeah, delete it. Okay. Now with the filler return, usually it's easier if you can take something that already exists in the product or the subassembly and just copy it and make some minor modifications to make it work with what you want. So we can select that, right click on it, and now copy that selected part. And then now we have an additional filler return. It's in the exact same spot in the product, so nothing's changing on our drawing yet, but we can go through adding a different part name, and we're just going to call this filler cleat quantity, width, length. So make the adjustments there if we want this to be minus 0.75, and this might be better if it was a prompt name, so the thickness, maybe the thickness of a material. We have a lot of different material pointers here. Let's try to do, let's see, we'll go the bottom return is the part that we're taking in consideration. So that's our filler. So in material pointers, we should have something called base filler, or since we're working with our upper product, we're gonna go down and find our upper filler. And we have our upper filler, and then right below that, we have our upper filler thickness. Once I hit okay, now that's changed. Instead of, be careful, make sure that we don't have anything in that formula we don't want. So there was a period that was still remaining. But now we have minus the material upper filler thickness. Be sure to hit apply formula. Now that's our new length. The origin, we want to make sure that it's not going to be at our zero origin in the Z. So zero meaning this bottom point down here. Now the Z origin, again, we're using the material thickness. So we can just add that, same way that we did to our cut part. Right next to the origin in our X, Y, and Z axis, we have the rotations. So this is going to be the way that the part gets rotated inside of our 3D model. So we have the X rotation, the Y rotation. You can see here in our preview window, there's the current part that we're working with and the different X, Y, and Z axis over here. So if we had it along our Z rotation, we would just be spinning it in this vertical orientation, if that makes sense. So Currently, it's set to 90. If I change this to 0 and see what happens, how we now have that turned the other way. If you haven't seen it already, make sure you check out our Build a Box exercise video. It'll really help when you're working with the different origins and rotations of parts. So anyway, we got that rotation now turned the right way. We have the origin correct. Well, not yet. I shouldn't say that yet. Our Y origin is also going to need to be adjusted. So currently, this is coming out to the face of the door. If we want to push this back to where it's right behind the thickness of the filler, we would now do the same thing like we did before and actually pick in the same name too, back into our paste name, upper filler thickness. Okay, so now I think we got that right. Let's go ahead and save and redraw so we can see what's happening. Now, before we get back into our drawing, you'll see that we have our subassembly save options. So this is what I was talking about in a previous video, where we have the option to save to a current row, the product, or other different save options. We're just going to pick the current row. And you can see there that we got it close, but it's not in the right X origin. So we're going to have to go back and change that. So it's sitting at the 0 origin. Kind of hard to tell, but this is our base point here. Now, when it comes to base points, we don't want to really mess with that too much. Check out another video where we're going to be learning about our part blocks, where we use our different base points and machine points. But for right now, let's just focus on keeping those base points and machine points as is, and just moving the origin and the rotation around to get it working right. Now, this will be a negative value. And because we're going to do another paste name, another define name, I should say, I want to start with an equal sign, go into our material pointer, and this time I'm going to pick our upper side thickness. And because I want it to be a negative value, I'll just squeeze a little minus symbol in there and hit apply formula. Let's save, close, and redraw, because I think we got it right. Let's just save it to the current row again. Let's change our view, make it a little bit easier, see if we got it. Yeah, so we have our filler cleat in there. It's positioned correctly. It's the right size. Now, we would have to double check to make sure that our material was correct. Currently, it's using the filler material that we had. Let's check that out. So filler return is using this two-sided material. Our filler cleat is also going to be using the same material because it was just a copied part. So we could update that, change it. The best way would probably be assigning a different pointer name to that part. So instead of it looking to filler material, you could look to something else inside of your material file, or even a brand new pointer name that you've created, maybe called filler cleat. Open up our edit design data into our subassemblies, scribe filler, right click, and now we can show that file. And there's our filler cleat that we just added. So all the data inside of the spreadsheet now. Now, if you are working in the spreadsheet, it's gonna be similar to Excel. If you're trying to add a new part, then it's as simple as copying the entire row and pasting it below. And now you have a new filler return and work with it similar to the way that we did in our part properties, but just now in this spreadsheet interface. Okay, so I think that's good. Hopefully that helps, you know, just a better understanding of how to work with different parts inside of your product too. And if you need to add something, make sure it ends up on the cut list. That's how you do it. So take what you learned, have fun adding some new parts to your products, and be sure to check out other videos where we talk about machine tokens and how those are working with all these different parts inside of our product and subassembly. All right, so that's it. You can go ahead and close out of this drawing and be sure to save your work. We'll pick it back up and have some more fun in our next training exercise. To learn more about changing the material on this filler cleat that we've added, check out our other video called New Material Pointer Name, going through the process of adding a new pointer name to our material file and also updating the formula inside of the part that's looking to that pointer name and specific material. So that's it for now. Thanks again for watching, and I'll see you next time for another training session in MicroVellum Toolbox.